Chancellor Fernando Sanchez Jr., Dean Josefina Bison, the members of the administration and faculty, guests, students, magandang umaga po sa inyo lahat. Medyo kinakabahan ako sa inyo kasi very formal kayo. At lalo po akong kinabahan yung nag-invocation ng lalim yung Tagalog ni Director. I was able to look at the program just today. Kinabahan pa din ako kasi I'm supposed to speak for 1 hour and 15 minutes. Sabi ko, pag ganyan, baka tulog na kayo lahat. Medyo makapal yung speech ko, pero huwag kayong mag-alala. Ano yan, font 20 na double space. Binibiro ko si Chancellor kanina. Sabi ko, parang mas bata siya sa akin kasi mga font 16 yan, Chancellor, sa'yo. Anyway, I came over today with, I'm going to introduce him, Councilor Gabby Guardado of Naga. He is an alumnus pala. Sanay ako sa all-girls school eh. He is an alumnus of SIPAC. And he was Jesse's, he was Robin to Jesse's Batman. Nung sixth terms po nag-mayor yung asawa ko, nung first term ng asawa ko, he was secretary to the mayor. The next two terms, he was city administrator of Naga. And yung pagbalik ng asawa ko, next three terms, he was my husband's vice mayor. Kaya ano to, siya yung, hindi po ako yung better half siya. In all the years that my husband was a public servant, I was just the wife. I was busy doing my own thing. I was a lawyer, I was an NGO worker, I was a community organizer. But I was never involved in my husband's work. Siya yung asawa ng asawa ko pagdating sa trabaho. Looking at the young faces of our students this morning, I cannot help but remember back when I was a bit younger than them. I was studying economics at UP Diliman. And at that time, we were still under the thumb of a dictator. I have to be very honest with you. It is very hard for me to talk of EDSA and the years under Marcos before a very young audience kasi parang hindi na nakaka-empathize sa nararamdaman namin noon. But anyway, one morning during our struggle, a white paper so bold and so fearless was going around the campus. It was written by our economics professors, who some of you may still know up to this day, isa po doon si Winnie Monson. That white paper wrote about the real economic picture that Marcos and his cabinet did not want people to see. It used the language of economists, and yet it was also emotional and full of heart. It was a very brave act. Back then, there was a fear that one could easily disappear and never be found again if you so much as say something ill of the Marcos administration. My professors didn't just teach us the audacity of dreaming for a better world. They allowed us to experience it. They told all of us, sana I won't be giving ideas to you students. They told all of us students to join the rallies. I remember I was in second year. I was, hindi ko alam kung sino yung taga-Diliman dito, pero nakatira ako dun sa Molave, nung nabaril si Ninoy. And from that time on, sunod-sunod na yung mass actions, until it culminated when I was in fourth year. I graduated 1986. And we had EDSA February before I graduated. Anyone who did was exempted from taking the final exams. Totoo yun. Our grading system then was simply pass or fail. Yung sa amin nun, nung tumindi na yung, I do not know if anyone was from my batch. Siyempre, wala na magsasabi kasi mahahalata yung edad. Pero yung tumindi na yung mass actions nun, we were given an option. Now, we can choose not to attend classes anymore as long as the reason for that is that we will be joining the mass actions. And kung ano yung status namin nung kami huminto pagpasok ng klase, yun na yung aming grade. Pero yung grade namin is only P or F. So, sino yung mga pumapasok? Yung status, F pa, kasi kailangan niyang maging P. At yung mga humahabol sa honors, kasi hindi siya makaka-honor kung P or F lang yung kanyang grade. In their academic wisdom, they so fit to teach students the real lessons from off the streets. But we are no longer fighting a dictator now. We are fighting different kinds of oppression. Those of apathy and materialism. Those of mediocrity and conformity. Those of dishonesty and selfishness. And when faced with a choice of what is easy and what is right, too many of us choose the easy way. You are, and I am referring to the students, students of the country's premier school, you must choose at all times what is right, even when that road is rough and tough. Being ethical in today's world may mean letting go of an easy life, but choosing the right is in itself the best reward. Earlier, I told you about the years leading up to the 1986 People Power Revolution. For both Jesse and I, that was a defining moment that influenced our decision to be public servants and to serve the way we do. Noong 1986 po yung asawa ko was a junior executive at the San Miguel Corporation, yung Magnolia Division. Ako naman, kag-graduate ko lang ng college. And my father, who was a long-time regional trial court judge in our city, yung panaginip niya talaga, ako yung panganay sa magkakapatid, yung panaginip niya, pag-aabugado din ako. And I was set to enter law school June, after my college graduation. But I went home to Naga, supposedly for my summer break. Pag-uwi ko ng Naga, yung mga kaklase ko nung high school, yung mga graduate ng LB, may mga kabarkada ko po, mga LB sila, told me that they were now working. At the time, they were already working. And they were working for a government office in Camarines Sur. At sinasabi nila parang, you know, that's why I said, napakahirap sabihin at napakahirap iparamdam sa mga kabataan ngayon kung ano yung pakiramdam ng mga kabataan noong 1986. Because everyone was inspired because of the People Power Revolution. Lahat gustong maging bahagi ng gobyerno. And when my high school classmates who were graduates of LB told me that there was this government office which was looking for economics graduates, at sabi nila yung namumuno noon bago, hindi parte ng dating administration, bago, bata pa, at parang very idealistic. Parang I was already so tempted to also apply. But nung una, natatakot pa ako na hindi ako payagan ng magulang ko kasi my future was already all planned. Maglo-law school ako, pagkatapos mag-aabogado ako tulad ng tatay ko. But you know, I mastered the courage to ask my parents if they would allow me to take a year off from law school and try working for government. And surprisingly, okay sa magulang ko. So I applied. Pero galing nun sa Marcos eh. And you know, I wanted so much to be accepted. Alam ko na yung bagong head was a nephew of our governor. So, yung governor, kaibigan ng tatay ko. So, pumunta ako sa office ng governor. I introduced myself as the daughter of my dad and asked for his recommendation. Kasi palagay ko, it would be a passport to being accepted. So nandun ako, pumila na ako. I took the exam, I was interviewed. Pero nung nag-interview ako, andito yung aking application form, yung sulat ni Governor nasa ibabaw. Yung nag-interview sa akin yung asawa ko. Siya yung boss. Siya pala yung young and idealistic new head of, the name of the office is Bicol River Basin Development Program Office. Si Gabi was also part of that office. Kaya alam ni Gabi yung aking love story. Nung nag-apply ako, nandun, yung letter ng kanyang uncle. Yung unang tinanong niya sa akin, ano ito? So parang gusto kong sabihin, hindi mo ba nakikita, application form ko yan. Pero I realized he was referring to the endorsement letter from his uncle. So I told him it's an endorsement letter from the governor. And he said, why do you have an endorsement letter? And it was at that point that it dawned on me that it wouldn't really be a passport. I told him, I was very honest. I was speechless at first, but I was honest. I told him I tried to get an endorsement letter because I thought it would help me get in. And he said, don't you realize na iba na yung gobyerno ngayon? Hindi yan kailangan. So I thought hindi na ako matatanggap. Ang tagal, I think it was June when I applied. Hindi na ako kinocall up ng July. At natatakot na akong sisihin ng mga magulang ko na I took a leave from law school, hindi naman pala ako makakapasok sa trabaho. And then August came, first week of August, I was called back. Ang sinasabi sa akin, kaya daw hindi ako nakakall back kasi yung ina-applyan kong position was already filled up. But would I be interested in a position which will require writing skills? So sabi ko naman, oo, but he said that he should first see if I really have writing skills. So pinasulat niya ako, tinanong ko, what would I write about? Ang sabi niya, any topic that you want. Sinulat ko the role of Cory Aquino in the EDSA Revolution. Sabi ni Gabi, I don't know if binubola niya ako because he was head of the communications department then. Doon ko daw napabilib yung asawa ko. To make the long story short, I was taken in. Pero ito yung trivia. My first day of work was August 18 of 1986. The day of the plane crash was also August 18 of 1992. So hindi ko alam kung konektado talaga yun. But anyway, that was almost 30 years ago, 29 years to be exact. So the revolution is older than our first daughter. Hindi ko pala na nakakabitan. I was accepted 1986 and a year after, we were married. Naalala ko lang, dami kong singit, baka kulang pala yung 11 o'clock. Anyway, naalala ko lang, you know, it was a whirlwind romance. And from day one, he talked about marriage already. And August ako pumasok, sabi niya, December, mamamanhi ka na siya. And I told my dad, hindi pala yung daddy ko, yung mami ko yung sinabihan ko, na mamamanhi ka na siya. Sabi ng mami ko, huwag, kasi galit yung daddy mo. Kasi nagkakakilala pa lang daw kayo, bakit mamamanhi ka na? So I told Jessie na hindi payag yung asawa, yung tatay ko. Pero sabi niya, basta may elections noon 1987, I think congressional election. Sabi niya, basta pagkatapos ng election, mamamanhi ka na, whether he likes it or not. So he did. Namanhi ka na siya kasama yung magulang niya. And the one thing that my dad told him was that I do not have any objections as far as you are concerned, but my anxiety is that meron daw akong panaginip maging abogado. Paano daw yung panaginip ko? Gusto ko sana sabihin sa daddy ko na ikaw yung may panaginip doon para sa akin. Anyway, my husband told my dad that he would make sure that even after we are married already, he would make sure that I will still go to law school. Kaya nag-aral po ako ng law school, may asawa na ako. And it took me a very long time because I couldn't go full-time because I was working during the day. Maliit lang naman yung sweldo ng mayor. So kailangan ng dalawa kami naghahanap buhay. I was teaching during the day and I was going to law school at night. Yung sa aming evening school, 5:30 to 8:30. Yung kinukuha ko lang po yung 5:30 to 7:30. Parang 8:30 naman nasa bahay na ako. But I would take a leave of absence every time I would bear a child. I would take a leave of absence every time there is an election so I can help in the campaign. I think it took me more than 7 years. Hindi ako seryosong law student. Naging seryoso lang po ako sa law nung abogado na ako. Kaya it is not really too late to pursue your dreams. Anyway, as I have said, that was almost 30 years ago. But you know, more than 30 years hence, we still have roughly the same issues. And the lesson is that the road from revolution to first world country is indeed long. Jesse used to say, during the years before he passed away, that good governance can be the conclusion of our unfinished revolution. We are done with uprisings. It is time for our daily collective acts of governance, transparency, and accountability to conclude what we or your parents fought for in 1986. Because you see, good governance is not about government alone. It is about the relationship of the government with its citizens. It is not about government decisions. It is about how we all make collective decisions that impact on our future. As students of this college and of this school, you are expected to have a huge role to play in running our country. Your generation and the following generations need you to be change makers and community builders. You have the skills, you have the knowledge, you have the resources, much more than what the average man on the street has. You cannot be bystanders. You must be active agents of social movements. Hindi ko alam kung naalala niyo yung credo ni Ramon Magsaysay. Ano ba yung credo niya? Naalala niyo? Hindi niya kilala si Ramon Magsaysay. Di ba siya yung nagsabing, those who have less in life should have more in love. And that is what all of us must strive to do. To anchor our changing world in principles, integrity, and ethics, so that those who need us would have more in law. It is often hard to fulfill our roles because we all feel so disconnected. When I first started to visit remote areas in my district, I marveled at how my constituents lived. It wasn't the physical poverty that surprised me. Sinasabi ko kanina, I was, you know, when I became a lawyer, alam ko na po na hindi ako pwedeng private practice lamang. Kasi pag private practice lang, asawa ko yung mayor. Yung lahat ng kliyente ko would expect that hindi ko sila sisingilin. And we needed a second income for the family. So nag-apply ako sa public attorney's office. Alam mo yung public attorney's office? Nag-apply ako doon. I became a public lawyer. Okay naman. For those of you who are still planning to go to law school and plan to go into private practice later, the best laboratory really is power. Kasi araw-araw, mga 15 yung litigation mo. Talagang hasang-hasak ka. And you know, I saw my future in it already. But public attorneys are supposed to defend indigent accused. Hindi ka prosecutor, kasi fiscal's office yun. Kami yung indigent accused. E nagkaroon ng conflict later on, kasi yung mga ipapahuli ng asawa ko, mga nag-wedding, ako yung mag-defend. Yung mga ipapahuli ng asawa kong drug addicts, ako yung mag-defend. So, yung asawa ko naman is a very supportive husband, pero hindi na yata niya nakayanan. Parang sinasabi niya, parang it's not working out. Eh tamang-tama, patapos yung kanyang third term as mayor. Some of you come from the provinces. Medyo uso yun sa probinsya na, your supporters would want that you stay one for power for a long time. Para sigurado din na parati lang silang malakas. And because term limit na yung asawa ko at hindi na siya pwede, gusto nila una pakandidatuhin yung asawa ko na congressman. Pero yung asawa ko sabi niya, parang being a legislator would not be my cup of tea. Ngayon pong congressman ako, sabi ko buti na lang hindi na congressman yung asawa ko. Kasi I am sure he would be very unhappy. Hindi niya talaga ito, hindi ito. Ano yun eh, lahat yung action. Ayaw niya ng masyadong diskusyon. And because my husband didn't want to run for Congress, the attention of the people turned to me. Ako na daw yung papalit sa asawa ko mag-mayor. And of course, we said no. Hindi naman, we never had any plans of perpetuating the family in power. So yung asawa ko nag-apply for a scholarship abroad, nag-aral siya sa Harvard, kasama kami buong pamilya. And that gave me the reason to resign from the public attorney's office, although I missed my job very much. When we went back, nag-NGO na ako. And it was the best decision actually. Because wala na kaming conflict tungkol dun sa dinidefend ko yung mga pinapahuli niya. Because after one term, he ran for mayor again and became mayor for another 3 terms. Pero as NGO worker, I became a very big support for my husband's work. Marami pong ipinasang batas yung aming sanggunian na yung nagka-craft yung opisina namin. I belong to an NGO called Centro ng Alternatibong Lingga Panlegal. Ano to, NGO of lawyers, and we try to empower the basic sectors, peasants, fisherfolk, urban poor, laborers, indigenous peoples, women and children. At maraming mga bago sa naga na kami yung tumulong na nag-craft na mga batas. Halimbawa, it is provided in our constitution that all the local sangguniyans should have local sectoral representation. Pero yung Kongreso hindi pa nagpapasa ng batas kahit halos 30 years na yung constitution. Pero yung naga meron na siyang local representation ordinance. Pero kami naga City People's Council because we have an empowerment ordinance. Yung mga ganun. Palagay ko, yun na yung mas totoo nang naging supporter ako ng asawa ko. So I was no stranger to poverty because that was how I work as an NGO worker. Part of our job was to empower the basic sectors. Pero by empowering, we went the course of trying to educate them of their rights under the law. Ang ginawa po namin, yung lahat ng mga halagang batas para sa mga sektor, trinanslate po namin yun in Bicol. Kaya yung lahat ng mga batas na para sa mga magsasaka, mangingisda, mga kababaihan, lahat yun may Bicol version kami yung gumawa. Kasi palagay namin, pag alam nila yung kanilang karapatan sa ilalim ng batas, mas lalo nilang maipapaglaban ito. You would be surprised that many of our brothers and sisters who are in the rural hinterlands, talaga walang access sa abogado. We had a program which I headed in Masbate. Maraming mga lugar na pumupunta yung judge once a month lang dahil sa layo. So, ang daming mga nakabinbin sa mga kulungan na mahihiri yung kaso nila once a month lang. At konting-konti yung abogado. So, we trained the basic sectors to fight for their rights by themselves. Kinapacitate namin yung mga community leaders para sila na yung magbibigay ng legal advice and those things. So my point here is I was no stranger to poverty. As I have said, I was in alternative lawyering for many, many years when Jesse was mayor, working with indigent groups, working with indigent groups and sectors. So I knew how they live. Nung para na po, yung head na ako ng women sector, yung mga tinutulungan ko na yung mga women in abusive relationships. And I would often shelter many of them in the middle of the night when I would get a call from out of the blue asking for help. So it wasn't really physical poverty that gripped me. It was the poverty of lawful protection. It was the poverty of spirit, even. It was the poverty of connections that clearly relegated them to a life of little means. I saw prisons that were not made of walls and steel. I saw prisons made of lack of justice and opportunity. These are the worst kinds of incarceration because it is neither crime nor the decision of a judge that puts you there, but a simple flick of fate when you lose in the ovarian lottery. At po nakakaawa. When I was still with Pao, I would often clean up my Friday schedule to visit the jails. Kasi yung mga kliyente ko, mga nasa jail. Ito yung mga indigent eh. So ito yung mga walang bail. Ito yung hindi nakakapag-pyansa. Kasi wala namang pag-pyansa. But I found out that so many of them have been serving sentence, kahit hindi pa sila convicted, have been there for so long already. Kahit yung sentence nila 6 months lang, pero nasa jail sila for 6 years na. Kasi walang nag-aasikaso ng mga kaso nila. So those things, talagang nakakapanlumo. And I realized that once you are born into poverty, the system is so rigged so that it is almost impossible to get out of it. So, ang lesson ko lang po dito lang sa inyo lahat, especially the young, your countrymen need you. Because for our country to crest that wave of economic revolution, we need inclusive growth. There will never be inclusive growth unless there is real participatory decision making. It is not just the government who needs to go to the grassroots. It is all of us. So number one, we must remember that good governance is not about government alone. Ilang beses ko po ito inuulit para hindi natin pag may nangyayari kasi ang sisi lahat nasa gobyerno. But good governance is how citizens engage with that government. Second principle is that it is not enough for public servants to be good. There has to be a system that molds him, teaches him, and gives him incentives to choose the right over wrong. There has to be a system that gives him a nudge towards adopting the kayo muna bago kami, ikaw muna bago ako mentality. That system, in fact, can spark the transformation of public leaders from good to great. Ito po parati ko itong narinig sa asawa ko. Parati niya sinasabi dati, it is not enough for a public servant to be good, but there has to be a system which forces him to be good. Pag pinag-aralan po natin yung ating public officials, marami naman yung nag-uumpisang Latino. Marami naman. Pero dahil sa power, dahil sa temptations, parang naliligaw ng landas. At dapat yung mga taong siya yung nakikipaglaban para sa atin, siya na yung dapat nating labanan. At nakakalungkot yun. Kaya kailangan po talaga may sistema. Third concept. We need to raise social accountability. Congress, at its very core, should be an accountability mechanism. In reality, the real work of Congress is not just to make laws, but also to make government agencies accountable for their use of public funds. But too much of our time in Congress is spent bringing projects to the people who voted for us. We fret over schools and roads and medical missions. We are measured by the amount of infrastructure we provide. Kaya nga, yung pinas talaga naka-poison ang sistema. It is almost as if we are driven by that need to focus on parochial concerns during budget hearings. Hindi ko po alam sa ating administrator, siguro si Chancellor nakapag-attend na ng budget hearing. Alam niyo po yung kasali po ako sa Committee on Appropriations. Before our very first budget hearing, my very first budget hearing pala for my term, inaral ko ng inaral yung budget na ganito kakapal. Kahit mahina yung mata ko, ang liliit ng fine print, talagang inaral ko. So that when the hearings come, I would be prepared. So yung first hearing, umupo na ako doon. Nashock po ako lang sa nangyari. Nashock ako sa nangyari kasi if you have ever attended budget hearings in Congress, parang siyang marketplace. Parang nandun yung agency heads na nagde-defend ng budget. But most, hindi ko naman sinasabing lahat, but most of the congressmen will not really ask for anything, any clarification on the budget that is being deliberated on. Pero ang pinaka-concern niya, ano bang mabibigay mo sa akin para sa akin distrito? And pag hindi yun nasagot, hindi binabypass, hindi pinapasa yung budget ng agency. And I became so disillusioned that I have, siguro napabayaan ko yung aking trabaho, pero hindi na po ako ganun ganado mag-attend ng budget hearings kasi parang nahihiya ako to be part of an institution na ganito yung ginagawa during budget hearings. But that's the reality. Just to be clear, I believe there is nothing wrong with wanting to help our constituents. But this practice funds patronage politics. And patronage politics spreads a dark shroud on good governance. It distracts us from the higher vision of using our precious time on the floor to be change makers and enablers. Instead of asking how many schools will be constructed in our district, we need to question government officials about whether they used public money judiciously for the greatest good. Instead of asking how many medical missions will be done in our districts, we need to analyze and measure performance. We need to think about how best to prioritize the 1,000,001 needs of the Filipino nation. We need to evaluate performance and thus make public officials accountable. Ito po yung trabaho ng Congress na oversight. Yung Congress po kasi dalawang klase yung major functions niya, lawmaking sa oversight. Yung oversight dapat tinitingnan niya if government agencies are doing their work well and using public funds judiciously. Pero mukhang yung dalawang major na work ng Congress, mukhang nakakalimutan yun. Talagang ang concern ng marami sa amin, ano ba yung madadala ko sa aking distrito so that I can be re-elected during the next elections. And we need to assess agencies, not to pinpoint blame. We need to help change wrongs in the system by exercising our oversight functions better. The legislature can be a refuge for good governance if we are enlightened enough to use the powers of our office the right way. At the moment, I can say we are still light years away from that vision. Let me also point out that the legislature is but one aspect in the chain of accountability. To more effectively keep our public officials honest and accountable to the people, we need to heighten citizens' participation in policy making. We need to encourage vertical, horizontal, as well as diagonal accountability. We need to improve the public space for real engagement between government and the people. In NAGA, we had the full disclosure policy way before it became a buzzword in the area of good governance. We practiced people empowerment, which led to the creation of the NAGA City People's Council. In the council, registered organizations get to vote on everything that the council is deciding on. Konting side issue lang po. Ano ba yung full disclosure? When my husband first became mayor of NAGA, he was only 29 years old at the time. Yung trust ng tao sa gobyerno niya was at its lowest. katatapos lang nung Marcos dictatorship. Very traditional yung style of governance. And one of the first things my husband did was to issue an executive order requiring all departments in City Hall to fully disclose all financial transactions. So hindi pa po nun uso yung internet. So nagkaroon ng transparency board. I don't know if any one of you ever visited Naga, but if you have, ang una nyo makikita pagpasok ng City Hall, ang isang wall na devoted sa transparency board. Yung lahat ng financial transactions ng City nakapost. Ngayon, hindi na lang sa City Hall, pero lahat na opisina na ng gobyerno at lahat ng mga barangay halls, meron na din. Pero yung transparency board is not just a repository of your mga financial documents na hindi naman maiintindihan ng tao. Kailangan that the documents which you will publish are in versions that are people friendly or consumer friendly. Sa ordinaryong tao, paano nila maiintindihan yung financial documents? Yung ginawa po ng asawa ko, yung lahat ng purchases ng Naga, saan niya yung binili at magkano yung bili niya noon, nakalagay. So gusto nung sabihin, pag bumili siya ng pako, nakalagay kung magkano yung bili niya ng pako at saan niya yung binili. Kung bumili siya ng biogesic para sa health center, nakalagay kung magkano yun. Parang ang liit na bagay, pero malaking-malaki po yung impact nun sa tao. Kasi yun yung nakaka-relate siya. Pag nakita niya, I do not know if you are following the Senate inquiry sa Makati. Pero nakita niyo, may mga items na binibili na dapat 47 pesos lang, nagiging 247. Yung nadadagdagan ng third digit. Pero pag nakapublish kasi yung lahat, yung gobyerno matatakot gumawa ng mali. Kasi kailangan nang i-disclose eh. Pag i-disclose niya at makita ng tao na sobrang mahal pala nung bili ng gobyerno, pwede siyang panagutin ng tao. So, I think that particular initiative became a very potent force when people started trusting their government again. Parang ano yun, parang simple yung ginawa, pero yung returns napakalaki. Kasi nung nakalagay na doon, ang tao naiisip, kahit hindi niya naman binabasa yung document, pero naiisip niya yung gobyerno namin walang tinatago. Kaya nakalagay dyan lahat. So mas yung tiwala bumabalik. Yung Naga City People's Council naman po, it is an initiative which was first introduced in Naga. Many other local government units tried to replicate this, pero unfortunately, hanggang ordinansa lang yung implementation, hindi masyado maayos pa this time. Pero Naga City People's Council po was giving power directly to the people. Ang traditional model, yung mga na-elect lang, saka na-appoint into office, yun lang yung may direct hand in governance. Pero sa Naga, may people's council, all the sectors are organized. Ang biro nga po namin, dahil lahat in-organized, pati yung mga labandera, planchadora, lahat yung organized, mga fishbowl vendor, bakit ganun yung track? Kasi napakahirap pakinggan kung very discordant yung voices. So in-organize yung lahat ng sectors para merong unified voice na pinapakinggan yung gobyerno. And hindi lang siya basta organisasyon. Pero pag-organize na sila, fene-federate siya into a people's council. And yung people's council, siya yung nag-decide kung sino ipapadala niya sa city. Pagdating sa city, lahat na committee may umuupo na representatives ng people's council. Meaning to say, you do not limit the exercise of governance to elected officials only, but you give space for direct people participation. Ano yung kapalit nito? Ang kapalit nito, unang-una, nabibigyan ng boses yung ordinaryong tao. Pangalawa, dahil binigyan mo siya ng boses, you get a more collaborative and cooperative constituency. Councilor Gabby can attest na ang dami pong increases sa taxes sa amin. Ang daming mga ginawa ng gobyerno na pag ginawa sa iba, magre-reklamo yung tao. Pero sa amin, yung tao mismo yung nagsasabi. Kasi alam niya. Alam niya yung parameters, alam niya yung circumstances. Tao na mismo ang nagsasabing kailangan na ito gawin na natin. So, naging very smooth po yung engagement ng government with naging very smooth pala. Tapos yung engagement naging very productive in the sense na yung mga hindi naman dapat mag-awayan, hindi na pinag-awayan. When my husband was appointed Interior Secretary, he brought with him all the models that transform our beloved city and was working actually on replicating the experience in all the LGUs across the country. One of that, and he issued this on the first month of his office as the ILG Secretary, was a memorandum circular requiring full disclosure of all financial documents of all LGUs and all agencies under the DILG. So parang yung model ng NAGA dinala niya sa DILG. And as I've said, not just municipalities and cities, but also barangays. He created the seal of good housekeeping. Hindi ko alam kung narinig niya na yun. He created the seal of good housekeeping, which was actually an incentive system for all LGUs to practice transparency and good governance. Parang yun nangyari mo kasi parang ang hirap ituro. So pipilitin mo silang mag-comply. Paano mo sila pipilitin mag-comply? Parati natin itong narinig. Ang mga departments po meron lump sum fund. Diba? Meron siyang lump sum fund. Yung ginawa po ng asawa ko, hindi niya hinayaan yun maging lump sum fund. But he asked the Department of Budget and Management permission if he can convert the lump sum fund into a performance challenge fund. Nung na-convert yun na performance challenge fund, ang pwede nung mag-access, yung lahat na LGUs na nabibigyan ng seal of good housekeeping. Meron yung three stages, meron gold, silver, and bronze. Depende kung ano yung mga na-achieve mo sa scorecards. So lahat na makaka-achieve ng scorecard and mabibigyan ng seal of good housekeeping would have access to the performance challenge fund. So kahit tatamad-damad po yung local official, masisisi siya pag hindi siya nabigyan ng project under the Performance Challenge Fund, hinahabol na. In fact, when my husband died, meron pending case sa Supreme Court. One governor, nakakalungkot pa kasi yun yung governor ng aming province, challenged the constitutionality of what my husband was doing. And just last month, the Supreme Court came out with a decision already saying that all that my husband did was to enforce and initiate accountability and transparency mechanisms, and there was nothing constitutional about that. So medyo smooth sailing, kasi medyo naantala po yun, kasi kini-question na. Medyo smooth sailing. To create a support system, he also started engaging the Catholic Church in good governance measures through the ugnayan ng barangay at ng simbahan, or UBAS. Dami ko ng kwento, baka hindi ko natapos. May isa pa sana akong kwento kung bakit in-engage niya yung Catholic Church. You know, when my husband first ran as mayor of Naga, there were six of them running. Anim po sila magkakalaban. Yung asawa ko po nanalo, but only by 900 votes. He was a minority mayor because while he was the top matcher of the six candidates, he only got 24% of the votes. His vice mayor then won, but of the 10 seats in the local Sanggunian, only three out of 10 won. So you can imagine, bago siyang mayor, batang-bata, pero tatlo lang yung kakampi niya sa konseho. At lahat na initiatives na ginagawa ng asawa ko, kukontrahin ng konseho. Halos wala siyang magawa. So what my husband did was seek the help of the Catholic Church. Very influential sa amin ang Catholic Church. Ay yung Archbishop namin, si Archbishop Legazpi. He sought the assistance of the Catholic Church and asked if the church can help the city create an environment to organize the sectors. Doon po actually nag-umpisa yung Naga City People's Council. Dahil meron ng parang meron parallel, di ba? Ito yung gobyerno, ito yung People's Council. Kahit ayaw ng gobyerno, pag yung People's Council nag-create ng pressure, napipilitan yung gobyerno sumunod. So that kept him afloat for 3 years. So natapos niya yung 3 years na marami siyang nagawa. But during the 5 succeeding elections, he won landslide. I am not too sure kung ilan yung pinanalo niya na, but I think it is in the range of 75% to 80% of the votes. Tama ba lang? 75% to 80% of the votes until his very last elections in 2007. Kung dati, tatlo lang sa konseho, yung lahat ng election niya succeeding dun sa first, lahat yung landslide. Until now, yung iniwan niya, lahat pa din landslide. Because, grabe na yung collaboration between the people and government. So, nung naisip niya to, again, he sought the help of the Catholic Church to engage with government. It was really a tough job. Culture, personalities, maturity in governance, state of institutions, all of these were different across LGUs. But trusting in systems and in people, he set out to pass memorandum circulars that would survive him after his stint was over. Nobody had a clue we would need these ordinances and memorandum circulars sooner than we thought. Jesse passed away, just as LGU started trusting in those systems he created. He was never able to see the full impact of what he did. And this is my job now. All of the bills that I filed are designed to finish his life's work. The full disclosure bill, which will require all government agencies to publicly disclose their financial documents. The Freedom of Information Bill, which will give people full access to relevant information from all agencies and LGUs. And the People Empowerment Bill, which will allow accredited civil society organizations and public organizations to have a seat at the table and vote on policies that impact the people. These three bills will empower citizens to make public officials accountable to the people in ways that we have never seen before. May i-advertise lang po akong konting pang-akyat ng bangko. Palagay ko yung FOI version that will come out of the House of Representatives will be so much better than the version which came out of the Senate. Ito lang po yung kung bakit. Kaya siya natagalan sa House kasi there were 24 versions. There were 24 versions. And the technical working group painstakingly tried to harmonize all the 24 versions. It took us a year. And we already have a compromise bill that came out of the committee already. Pero yung version ko po, which was adopted by the committee, was it transforms the FOI from a demand-driven FOI into a supply-driven one. Yung version po kasi ng Senate, ang sinasabi lang, basta nagre-request yung ordinary citizens, government is required to make public, to give the information. Pero yung version ko po, even without request, government is already mandated to make public information. Kahit walang nagre-request, kasi ang mangyayari kasi pag nagre-request ng dalawang bagay. Una, wala nang gagawin yung gobyerno kundi magsagot ng request. In fact, that was the opposition of government to the FOI. Can you imagine if all of you here in the room would be requesting for the same thing? Ang Senate version ng FOI, ako yung gobyerno, obligado akong bigyan kayo ng isa-isa. Pero yung version ko po, ang gobyerno, obligado na siyang i-make public yung lahat na information, even without need of request. So that, kung kailangan mo, you don't want to go through the entire process of requesting and waiting for your request to be given, pero with just one click of a finger, nandun na yung information. Number two, halimbawa yung gusto mo wala dun sa in-upload, you can always request. But then when government gives in to your request, government is obliged to already make public whatever document you requested. Meaning to say, if I made it available to one, I make it available to all. Number three, in my version also, which was adopted by the House, the information that has to be uploaded should already be in a people-friendly form. Hindi na yung mga PDF. Pero dapat, ito, parang translated na into documents which will be understood by ordinary people. So kahit natagalan, palagay ko mas magiging maganda, mas proactive, mas mas iniisip yung pangangailangan. Kasi ang iniisip ko po dati, kung yung ordinary FOI, karamihan sa interesado yung naghahanap lang ng diferensya sa gobyerno. Because you are willing to go through the entire process of asking and waiting and following it up and etc. etc. Pero kung nandyan na, kahit hindi ka naghahanap ng fault sa gobyerno, the information is there. It is already available. And this is really an exciting time to be involved in public policy. There are so many new ways to interact with policy-making bodies on so many different levels. This is the golden age of good governance in the Philippines. And with your support, I hope to see this enlightenment happening within my lifetime. Jesse did it. His life was far too short for him to see his dreams of good governance come into fruition. He would often talk about these dreams with colleagues and friends. Parati niyang sinasabi, maabutan ko pa kaya. At parati niyang sinasabi, may patutunguhan kaya yung lahat na ginagawa ko. But we really have to be serious about good governance. We do have to care enough to aim for real engagement and not turn our backs when we don't seem to see eye to eye. Public participation in governance is a long and arduous process. It is messy. It can be clouded by personalities and cultures and ideological backgrounds. But in a democratic society, it is the right way towards a happy nation. Nag-privileged speech po ako ng wedding, nag-privileged speech ako ng death anniversary ng asawa ko. Yung privileged speech ko was a precursor to my filing the People Empowerment Bill. And after I delivered my privileged speech, most of the reactions of my fellow congressmen was, bakit mo naman bibigyan pa ng space yung people participation sa governance na tayo na nga yung inelect ng tao? Parang tayo niyan, parang kumukuha tayo niyan ng bato na ipupukpok sa ulo natin. Pero totoo po, totoo. Para tayo kumuha ng bato na ipupukpok sa ulo namin kasi sobrang ang daming mag-uusap-usap, sobrang daming boses yung papakinggan. But we did it inaga. Even if the process is long and tedious and messy sometimes, it produces the best results. Kaya yun din yung aming pinapanaginip. Jesse is gone, but we are not. We need to ask ourselves this. What will we do with our storehouse of living hours? Losing Jesse has made me more conscious that we will never know when our plane can crash, figuratively speaking, of course, and that I better fill my days with things worthy of his time. I have no experience in politics before I became a member of Congress, but nothing quite prepares you for public service as seeing someone like him in action. Sabi ko nga po, I had front row seats to his kind of service. The way he rode garbage trucks with garbage collectors himself when he was mayor to make sure that the task is done right. The way he would find a way to institutionalize policies to make sure they would continue after his term. The way he would go around in slippers and shorts and talk and more like listen in fact, with people on the ground. Hindi ko po alam who among you had the chance of meeting him, and especially visiting him in City Hall. Madalas po namin yung pinag-aawayan kung ano yung damit niya. Parati niya pong sinasabi, ayoko niya eh, kasi Makati, uncomfortable. And I would always tell him, you don't have to dress up too well, you just have to dress appropriately. And that was something he never understood. Ito po, last na kwento. Parati ko itong pwede kwento. Nung first sola po ng asawa ko, secretary na siya ng DILG, I was excited. I was inaga kasi pag-inaga pa naman ako until the day he died. He lived in Manila with our two older daughters and would go home to Naga during weekends to be with me and the youngest. Nung magsusola na, hinanap ko po yung mga barong niya na yung mga ayos, yung mga husi, hinanap ko yun.
pinadala ko sa kanya sa Manila, I sent him 3. Sabi ko, ito ha, pag magsosona, kailangan, ganito yung gamit mo. Kasi yung sona, formal, kasi nakita ko yung invitation eh. Yung ladies, Filipiniana, yung gentleman, formal barong. So sabi ko, isa ito. So, sona. Nag-uumpisa na, nanonood ko ako ng TV sa bahay. Nagpapasokan na yung mga tao, nahanap ko yung asawa ko, hindi ko mahanap. Talaga yung mata ko nakatutok. Nung mag-uumpisa na, saka siya pumasok. Pero yung barong niya po maiksi. Yung barong niya maiksi, hindi lang maiksi sa body, pero pati yung arms maiksi din. So galit na galit ako, kasi hindi niya na naman ako sinunod. I was trying to call him up. In-off yung cellphone. Siguro bawal kasi na naka-on. In-off. So, the entire time that the president was delivering his son, I was steaming. Kasi hindi na naman ako sinunod ng asawa ko. Although, parati naman talaga siya hindi sumusunod sa akin. Pero finally, I sent him several text messages. And finally, after the sauna ended, he called me up. Tuwan-tuwa siya. Tuwan-tuwa siya kasi that was his first sauna. Ako naman galit na galit. Sabi ko, pinagpagurat ko yung pag-ayos ng barong. Binilin ko pa kung paano yung isustore, paano pa pransyan, tapos hindi mo ginamit. And he explained. Sabi niya, hindi. I really intended to use one of the barongs that you sent me. And in fact, I had one in my car already going to Congress. Pero syempre, isusuot niya yun pag kailangan na isuot kasi nakakatihan nga siya. So naka-t-shirt lang siya sa loob. Pero doon nung sinuot niya, meron palang butas na malaki sa side. Siguro hindi namin napansin kasi matagal naman hindi ginagamit. Eh hindi naman siya papapasukin without a formal barong. Yung kanyang aid, buwas in barong, pinahubad niya at siya yung magsuot ng barong. But the aid, although medyo pareho silang katawan, was much shorter than he was. So, parang he dismissed me and told me, wala namang nakakapansin, ikaw lang. So, he never really cared about appearances. Yun yung ano talaga. And pag nag-opisina siya sa City Hall, madalas naka-shorts lang siya at naka-chinelas. And talagang ano yun. Hindi naman ako mahilig magbihis, pero I always make it a point that I dress appropriately. And I always explain that to him, pag nag-a-attend ka ng pasyon, lalo na pag pinagandaan naman nung nag-invite sa'yo, magdadamit ka naman na maayos kasi baka akalain nila na parang hindi mo binibigyan ng importansya yun. Pero sa kanya kasi ayos na yun eh. Basta malinis lang, ayos na yun. But that was my husband. The way he would strategize from branding to communications to financing programs, the way he would be the first man in and the last man out during disasters. Both on the micro and macro side of governing, Jesse was consistent. Public service was about protecting those who had less, so that they will have more. Everything revolved around that. Kaya klaro sa kanya lahat. So, the final message for this afternoon is, and this is the lesson I also got from Jesse, it is only when we put power back in the hands of the people who empower us, only when we govern with the most basic of values, like trust, integrity, honesty. Only when we are all matino, mahusay, at bukas, can we be worthy of this great nation we seek to serve. Thank you very much.
Gerona-Robredo, thank you very much for sharing with us your stories and words of wisdom. So I hope more public leaders and citizens would see good governance the way you do. In this time of too much negativity towards government, your words are a breath of fresh air to all of us. So yes, we as in all of us, and not just the government, have to be serious about good governance. So at this point, we now open the floor to questions. I'm sure our audience are excited to ask questions. So So for those who would be asking questions, please come to the mic. So we have one here in front and one over there in the middle. So please introduce yourself first. And then may we request that each of our students or each of our guests would just ask one question so that the others will also have an opportunity to ask their questions. So let's, yes, at the back first. Yes, sir.
Good morning. I'm Eunice Balista from Physics Division. I'm also from Mulan. My question is, we're fortunate to have a husband that you can be proud of. But there are many officials that they themselves are good, but their spouses or their friends or their children are there undoing. So what is your advice for those cases? Because I know that a person is responsible for himself, okay? But if you want to go to public office, the test of your ethics is the hardest test of your ethics is your family. So what is your advice to those people in that situation?
I will be very honest. I think it will be very hard. It will be very, very hard to take a different route from what your from the route your predecessors take. But it was also what my husband did. I was telling you earlier that he was a protege of our governor. The governor was his uncle. He was the one responsible for making my husband run as mayor of Naga. But you know, when he already won, ito kinikwento, ayoko mag-advise kasi I don't think I will be in any position to do that. Pero I am just telling you how my husband did it. Nung nanalo na po siya, ang grabe yung wetting sa amin. Grabe yung wetting sa amin. And my husband believed that the chief of police in Naga was on the take. Because he said that wetting cannot proliferate in any locality without the consent of the mayor and the chief of police. He was very sure of himself that he wasn't on the date. So he thinks that his chief of police was. Kasi kahit anong order yung ginagawa niya, parang meron lang mga token ng mga arrests. Pero hindi seryoso sa campaign. And my husband fought for his removal from office, at least from Naga. Pinagawayan nila yun. And later on, he would find out that even his uncle was on the take. So hindi na siya sumusunod. And that caught the ire of his uncle so much so that he filed a kasi three years lang yung term. Ano yun, 1988, mag-election ulit 92. Kasi yung first term niya was actually 4 years because it was a transition. Nung magkakandidato na siya, his uncle fielded his sister na kumalaban sa asawa ko. So yung kalaban ng asawa ko was his aunt. Tapos, his uncle filed a disqualification case against him on the ground that he is a Chinese citizen. Kasi my father-in-law is pure Chinese. My father-in-law is pure Chinese but born in the Philippines. My husband is Chinese, half Chinese because his mother is pure Filipina. But they were never even educated in Chinese schools. My husband went to Ateneo and La Salle College. Hindi nga marunong mag-inchik yung asawa ko. Although some of his siblings got married to Chinese people. Pero in all the 6 elections that my husband, in all the 5 pala kasi except for the first, parati siyang may pending disqualification case. So why am I telling you this? That if you choose to tread a different path, yung lahat na balakid ibibigay sa'yo. Yung lahat na kahirapan ibibigay sa'yo. And you have to ask yourself if you are strong enough and ready enough to fight all those hindrances. Kasi yung mag-asawa ko, he was on his own. He was on his own during the succeeding elections. He had no political godfather anymore. And ultimately, it proved to be the best. He was able to chart his own course. Siya na yung nagdikta kung saan siya patutungo. Walang pinaghihinayang at walang iniingatan na relationships. But of course, if it is your wife or your husband or your, di ba, parent, I think it will be much different. It will be even harder. Baka mas madali sa asawa ko kasi uncle. Pero pag sarili mo na kasing tatay, sarili mo anak, sa amin nangyayari yun eh. Ngayon nangyayari yun sa amin, without naming names. Merong anak na pinakandidato, yung lumaki na yung anak, nilabanan na yung tatay. Okay naman sana yun. Okay naman sana yun. Pero, sabi ko po ma'am without naming names. Huwag na kayo magsabi na familiar kasi ayoko naman makipag-away. Yung problema lang, ang tanong, humiwalay ka ba for what reason? Diba? Kasi kung humiwalay ka kasi gusto mo din mag-build ng sarili mong political base, palagay ko hindi worth yung paghihiwalay. Yung politics and power is not worth severing family ties. Pero yung paghiwalay mo because ipinaglalaban mo yung iyong prinsipyo, palagay ko it is worth the fight. Pag humiwalay ka kasi gusto mo mas maayos yung daan na dadaanan mo, palagay ko worth yun. Kasi hindi na lang pamilya yung sinasalba mo, pero sinasalba mo yung sambayanan. Pero kung problema, we are observing so many families now na nagkahiwa-hiwalay dahil sa politika. We do not want to judge, pero most of the time kasi, yung reason din, ayaw nang bitawan yung political power, and it is sad.
So before we accommodate the next question, so we have actually a live streaming of this event. So you can text your friends or not here to watch this forum via streaming.uplb.edu.ph. So streaming.uplb.edu.ph. Perhaps they would want to hear the question and answer portion. So this live streaming is brought to us by UPLB. OBCPD, IDC, and ASTIDOS. Thank you. So now let's move on to the next question. So to the other side of the room, yes. I'm not wearing that glasses. Heidi.
Good afternoon po, Mrs. Gerona-Robredo. Itatanong ko lang po, since ang topic po natin ay ethics and governance for development, na sinabi niyo na nga po na ang progreso sa gobyerno ay nagmumula sa tiwala ng mga mamamayan sa gobyerno. In light po dito sa nangyaring Fallen 44 natin na member ng SAF o ng staff na 44 po ang nalaga sa ating sandatahan sa hashtag po sa ating Twitter nawawala ang hindi yan po nawawala. Pero nasaan ang Pangulo na hindi po siya na pumunta sa kung saan sa pagsalubong sa mga nagbuwis ng buhay para sa kapayapaan natin sa parte ng Mindanao. Ano po ang opinion sa nangyari? Ilang
sa ethical side, okay. Ako po I also disagree with a lot of things that the government did. And I also think that things would have been better. Pero yung sa akin kasi, ang pakiramdam ko, it is very legitimate to air our outrage. Kasi talaga may dahilan. Pero yung sa akin lang, palagay ko dapat mas ano lang. After nasabi na natin yung outrage, sana mas constructive na lahat. Yung ating mga ginagawa dapat pinag-iisipan at hindi lang knee-jerk yung reaction. Alam niyo, sa amin po mga politiko, we could have made several pronouncements that will make us bogey sa iba, di ba? Pero I don't think that will at all help. Palagay ko kung mali yung gobyerno, sabihin natin na mali. Pero yung sa akin lang, mas ang hanap solusyon. Kasi hindi naman nakakatulong yung calling government officials names. Hindi din nakakatulong na ayaw na natin mag-move on. Hindi nakakatulong na niroromanticize natin masyado lahat. Kasi, halimbawa, nakakaiyak yung nangyari sa 44. Pakiramdam natin, at least ako, pakiramdam ko, hindi sana kinailangan yun kung na-handle siya ng mas maayos. Pero hindi din natin dapat kalimutan na, aside from the 44, ang pinag-usapan dito hindi lang yung sa side ng Moro. Pero even before, halimbawa, nung time ni President Erap na nag-declare siya ng all-out war, ang namatay sa ating mga sundalo, 200 plus. Ang namatay sa MILF, 400 plus. Parang tayo, masyadong tayong focus dun sa 44, na nakakalimutan natin na napakarami nang nagbuwis ng buhay. At dapat ang iniisip natin na resulta, yung mas matagal. Hindi lang yung solusyon na mas romanticized, hindi lang yung solusyon na mas emotional, pero yung solusyon na hinahanap natin. Paano ba natin bibigyan sa isa yung buhay ng 44? Bibigyan natin sa isa yung buhay ng 44 kung sisiguraduhin natin na sila na yung huli. Di ba? Parang hindi natin, they will surely die in vain if we allow our emotions to get the better of us. Yun naman yung sa akin. It is perfectly okay to air our outrage. I am as outraged as many of you are. Pero I think, mas, di ba, parang huwag tayong padalos-dalos. In the sense na, paminsan kasi, parang sa ordinaryo din, di ba? Parang sa ordinaryo. Ako parati ko po yan tinuturo sa mga anak ko, na pag galit ka, huwag ka na magsalita. Magsalita ka pag hindi ka nagalit. Kasi sometimes, you tend to say many things, you tend to act irrationally because you let your emotions get the better of you. Yung sa akin, okay to express, pero kung may mga gagawin, gawin natin after tayo, nakapag-isip na. Yun naman sa akin. And dapat hindi natin i-regard na kaaway. Hindi natin i-regard na kaaway yung gobyerno, hindi natin i-regard na kaaway yung mga Moro. I-regard natin tayo lahat ng mga Pilipino sabay-sabay na naghahanap ng solusyon.
Thank you, ma'am. You remind me of my wife. But my system in making her remove, I forget to be angry at me is I kiss her, I embrace her, and I say, I love you very much. But thank God she is now in New Jersey and I am free. I'd like to ask you, ma'am. I'm now 86 years old and I retired from the College of Forestry and the ERDB here. But at 86, I think I can still be as young as a student. But I think you have not given much advice to us, older folks. What can we do? Thank you very much.
But shouldn't you be the one giving me advice? I mean, you have seen the world already. You have gone through so much, more than I have. Pero even if every one of you in the audience is much younger than I am, parang I always feel I am in a position to give any advice. I can only relate to you similar experiences. Pero there's no
no real formula for doing things. What might work for me might not work for you. Kaya yung sa akin na po mas experiential lahat. That's why I don't want my speeches to be very theoretical. Kasi parang ang hirap, di ba parang ang hirap maintindihan. All that I ever share with you are experiences that I have gone through. And I haven't had much. You might have had more, much more than I have. And I think between the two of us, you are in a better position to give advice.
Okay, so let's have a question from the back.
Yes,
Miss Maranda, what did I get off? Salamat. Thank you for your very wonderful call. My question is an easier one. A while ago, you told us that you were quite frustrated during budget hearings that you napabayaan ng konti ng trabaho mo. If you could share with us what made you come back, what did you do, how did you come back to the work after your frustrations?
Ano lang yun eh? Ano ba? May mga trabaho tayo. May mga obligation tayo na kahit ayaw natin, kailangan natin gawin. Hindi ko lang, you know, I do not know if any of you is friends with my eldest daughter. Pero yung eldest daughter ko, when she was in her first job, masyado siyang maraming frustration. She was working with a consultancy firm before. And baliktad yung oras niya. Yung boss niya nasa New York, baliktad yung oras niya. She couldn't participate in any of the family events. So, ini-email niya yung papa niya. Yung papa niya dati mayor pa lang. Wala pa. So, yung anak ko was living on her own in Manila. We were all together, the four of us, Jessie, me, and the two younger ones, Inaga. And my daughter was emailing me, my husband, sinasabi na yung lahat na inis niya sa trabaho. And sinasabi ng asawa ko na ganyan talaga yung buhay eh. Meron ka mga gagawin na ayaw mo namang gawin, pero necessary gawin mo. Kasi with the benefit of hindsight, parang these are the dots that really connect you to where you are at whatever point in your life. And that's the same thing with me. Even if I'm frustrated with the budget hearings in Congress, it's an obligation. I am a member of the appropriations. It's my obligation to study the budget and you participate in the best way you could. Kahit hindi yun pareho ng participation ng iba. If you have any concerns, you ask your concerns. But the one thing is that you have to remember that you don't have to be like them. Palagay ko yun yung challenge parate. Yun yung challenge parate na huwag kang madala sa agos. Dahil ginagawa ng iba, gagawin mo din. And I think I have to say this, hindi naman lahat sa Kongreso ganun. Marami din naman ng mga good, hardworking souls in Congress. Hindi naman ako nagsasabi ako lang yung ganun. Hindi naman. Actually, I look up to many of them. Marami naman yung nagtatrabaho na maayos talaga yung pagtingin. Pero I just related to you that particular point because I really feel that if Congress is more, ano ko ba sasabihin? Hindi naman siguro. Na-conscious na kasi ako kasi sabi mo na live stream, akala ko tayo mag-usap. Pag siguro yung Kongreso mas seryoso siya sa kanyang trabaho na lawmaking and oversight, mas maganda sana yung kalalabasan. But you know, you cannot say na tatalikod na ako, ayoko na kasi hindi ito yung gusto ko. Because really the reality is that things cannot be the way you want them to be. And you have to learn how to, di ba? You have to learn how to react in any given situation. But parati lang na nasa isip mo yung basic. Ano ba yung mandate ko? Ano ba yung commitment ko? Ano ba yung obligation ko? With all your principles intact. Siguro ganun lang.
Can Sir go out here in the back? Yes, sir.
Thank you po sa magandang lecture at marami kaming natutunan. Ako si Justado Lopega from the Division of Political Science, Department of Social Sciences and Social Sciences. Actually, this is not a question, but I just would like to solicit your comments on this. Tungkol sa nangyayari ngayon sa Makati, you know, alam naman natin, nababasa natin na yung mga ganon. In the legislation, iniimbitahan yung sina Chito Pinay, Vice President Pinay. Ngayon, nung huling nangyari, di inano na si Junjun Pinay dahil hindi siya pumupunta doon. To the point na pinadalhan siya ngayon ng ano ng sine para mag-attend. Ang nakakats ng aking attention, nandoon yung dalawang lawyers na nirerespeto ko pa naman sila noon. Si Arroyo at saka si Sagisa. Sayang, sabi ko. Kasi noong panahon ni Corey Aquino, yung mga tao na iniidolo ko. But then they were there. At sinabi pa nila na they will defend Junjun Pinay. So, yung comment ko, ma'am, doon sa nangyari na yun, ano ba talaga? Yung ethical na ginawa ni na Sagisag at ni, Arroyo. What is your comment on that?
Napakahirap naman. Teacher ko pa naman si Professor Sagisag sa masdaral ko. Hindi, ganito na lang. Bago kayo sagisag sa kay Arroyo, parang nakikita ko, parang yun din yung parating ethical dilemma ng mga abogado. Kasi mga abogado may lalapit sa'yo, sasabihin na, can you defend me? Ang tanong kasi, pag alam mo na siya yung may kasalanan, in your court, pero yung obligation mo is to defend, di ba? In conscience, kaya mo bang i-defend ang isang tao na alam mo may kasalanan? Actually, that was my dilemma when I was with the PAW. Kasi sa PAW, hindi ka nakakapili ng kliyente. Clients are assigned to you. Ikumanto ko kung paano ko ni-resolve yung dilemma. Yung parati kong hinihingi sa kliyente ko, be very honest with me. Ayoko nang sinisinungalingan mo. O kaya master ko ako, tumingin ko sino nagsisinungaling, saka hindi. Na master ko yun when I was with Pao. Kasi karamihan talaga nagsisinungaling. Pero sa akin naman, I had to perform my lawyer duties. Kailangan ko siyang i-defend. Pero kailangan ko ba siyang ipawalang sala na alam ko naman na may sala siya? Ako, palagay ko yun yung question niya. At palagay ko yun din yung ganun din, yung kay Joker Arroyo sa kay Rene Sagisan. Kung paano ko na-settle yun sa akin, ako, gagawin ko yung lahat within the bounds of law. To give him yung parang pinakamagiging magaan sa kanya. Halimbawa, kung totoo ka naman na may sala, I normally advise my clients na mag-guilty na lang. Ine-explain ko lahat, mababawasan yung kanyang sentence, baka pwede pa siya mag-probation, etc. etc. Halimbawa, may mga exempting or mitigating circumstances doon sa ginawa niya, i-explain ko yan at ipapakita ko. Pero hindi to the point of exculpating him from the crime he committed. And I think, to be very fair, I think that was also that was also why Joker and Rene Sagisag were there. The reasons why they were there. Although they have been very good friends with the Vice President for a long time. So siguro naman yun din yung underlying reason. Pero as a lawyer, I would want to look at it as gusto lang nilang siguruhin na yung rights ng kanilang kliyente protected. Kasi kahit naman nagkasala, may karapatan, di ba? Kahit may sala, may karapatan. Pero ito, hindi na to kay Arroyo saka kay Sagisang. Ito na yung issue of corruption. And that is precisely why I said in my speech that it is very important that we pass laws which will provide institutions, which will provide the parameters na sisigurado, that will force good people to stay good. Kasi I do not know if you have been hearing stories. I do not know the vice president or any of his children before. Pero maraming kwento, maayos naman yan noon. Di ba? Maraming human rights lawyer, etc., etc. Pero yun nga yun, I think that's the ethical challenge of every public official. Marami talaga pumapasok na maayos. Pero dahil nakatikim ng power and privilege, medyo umiiba yung, di ba? Parang umiiba talaga yung pagkatao. And I, you know, when my husband was still alive, that's what he kept telling me, that every day we need to pray together. Na yung strength. Kasi hindi mo naman, parang no one is a paragon of virtue. We face the same temptations as the ordinary non-government official face. Pero yung ano yun, if you are always aware that this is a challenge, if you are always aware of your vulnerabilities, you are in a better position to fight them off. Pero pag sinabi mo na kasing hindi, kasi ako mabait ako eh. Hindi kasi ako maayos ako, kaya hindi ako matetempo. Kaya hindi ka aware na natempo ka na pala. Pero kung everyday pag gumigising ka, pagdadasal mo na po sana, kung ano man yung dumating ngayon. That's why it's really an effort. Ako, I will be very candid with you. Nung naging congressman ako, medyo marami talagang privilege na ino-offer along your way. Parang everything is being, you are being offered an easy life. Diba? Parang to a certain extent, you will be tempted. Kasi, halimbawa ako, I take the bus every week, moving home to Naga. Bakit naman ako magpupas? Na pwede naman sagutin ng opisina ko yung plane ticket. Kahit mahal, sasagutin naman yung opisina ko. But why do I take the bus? Diba? Pero it's a way of making sure that you are still the same person that you have been before you became a public official. Pag nagmamasters po ako sa San Fede, but I took a leave this semester. Diba, pumunta ako sa San Fede, nag-LRB ako. Wala naman nakakakilala sa akin except one time. So, why make a big deal out of it? Diba? Gusto ko sabihin, if you exert, this is something that sometimes my staff do not understand. Sinasabi ko kasi nandito sila ngayon eh. Paminsan din nila naiintindihan na I really assert na mag-isa, na I drive myself, na bakit may driver naman pero pinipilit mo ikaw yung mag-drive sa sarili mo. Parang it's a way of, di ba? It's strengthening your core eh. Kasi if you let others do things for you all the time, chances are you will get used to it. And chances are, even after your term expires, you do not want to leave anymore. And that's the reason why we have political dynasties. That's the reason why pagkatapos congressman, mayor naman, pagkatapos mayor, governor naman, kasi ayaw nang umalis. Because the privileges are being enjoyed already. But if you stop yourself from enjoying those privileges, it will be very easy for you to go back to private life. Kung ngayon, hirap na hirap ka dahil sa sweldo mo, hirap na hirap kang pagkasyahin yung sweldo mo. Pagkatapos yung term mo, pasalamat ka pa na makakahanap buhay ka na ng maayos. Pero kung nakaupo kang congressman pero nagre-receive ka ng SOP sa mga projects mo, pagkatapos ng term mo, hindi mo na maiiwan yung yung position mo kasi saan ka nakukuha ng extra income na in-enjoy mo. Yun po yung parati kong biro kay Gabby. Si Gabby po ang explain poverty yan. Kaya sinasabi, hanggang ngayon wala siyang bahay. Kaya, I don't know if you understood what I explained.
One of our students, I assume.
Good morning po, ma'am. Ako po si Tony from the College of Human Ecology. Taga-counselor po ako and I saw the schools in public schools in Naga. Napadpad din po ako sa Batangas. And one thing ironic po sa mga schools nila sa public schools in particular sa Batangas is meron pong pangalan parang Congressman, someone type of building. Congressman, someone type of building. Now, in relation po sa accountability, is it a mere sign of being accountable sa mga projects ng politicians or actual early campaigns na po? And what is your opinion about it po? Thank you.
Nako, marami sa akin magagalit. Galing off mo na natin yung live stream. Ako po sinabi mo na din lang, sa Naga, meron din mga school buildings na nakapangalan sa politicians. Pero hindi sa asawa ko. Walang ni isa. The only time na may pinangalan po sa asawa kong government building was after he died already. Yung coliseum namin was named after him. But that's the only building in Naga that was named after him, and it was named after him after he died. Pero if you go around my district, nagsisigawan po na yung mga buildings namin nakapangalan sa mga politicians. Ang nakakalungkot kasi hindi naman yung pera nila. Ako I would not have any problems with private people having buildings named after them or their ancestors if those came from funds from them. Pero yung funds from DepEd, pinapangalan sa mga paaralan. And I think it's scandalous. Pero parang naging ugali na sa atin that we excuse them already. Di ba? Parang sa atin, normal. Ang tingin ko parang, halimbawa po ako, wala ako ni isang carpoolin sa amin. Pag pumupunta ako sa, kaya nahiya po ako dun sa ano, pagpasok ko may... Actually po, pag nakakakita kami na, hindi yung nasa entrance chancellor. Hindi ito. Pero yung nasa may entrance, may tarpaulin. Gusto ko pong ipahinto yung sasakyan para picturean. Kasi halos wala. Nagkakaroon lang po ako ng tarpaulin pag yung nag-imbita sa akin, naglalagay. Pero parang with all other officials, ano yan, parang normal. And in fact, in my district, kaya nga na, halimbawa sa baba, kung politiko, pag nagpe-fiesta sila, gusto nila maglagay ako ng tarpaulin. Para lang pagbigyan sila, naglalagay po kami tarpaulin, pero nakalagay ng happy fiesta, walang pangalan, no anything. Pero parang it has been part of our culture already. Na even ordinary people excuse that. Ang gusto sabihin, not too many are scandalized when they see government buildings named after. Di ba, parang sa atin, ano lang eh. Parang, okay, normal. And I think it is sad. It is sad kasi dapat sana yung anti-epal natin sustain yung campaign. Di ba? Dapat yung anti-epal sustain yung campaign in the sense na pag pinapabayaan kasi yung government official, namimihasa. Hindi, di ba? Parang yung hiya level hindi mataas. Kasi dahil walang nagre-reklamo, akala okay lang. Pero sa Naka, parang ito, di ba gabi? Sa Naka, parang iba na yung mindset ng tao. Yung sa Naka, parang kahit gustuhin namin maglagay ng tarpon, mahihiya kami maglagay. Kasi siguradong maiinis sa amin yung mga tao. Yung ganon, na I think the constituency should be like that. na public officials should be ashamed when they make EPAL, especially of government, using government funds.
So I know many of us still want to ask questions. However, we can only accommodate one last question. But then perhaps meron po tayo ng ibang way pa para makapagtanong kay Congresswoman.
Anyway, yung tanong ko naman po ay baka ma-involve ang lahat. What particular challenge would you like to throw to schools, especially higher education institutions? At para naman hindi nyo masabing kayo lang ang tinatanong ko, being part of the academy, pwede rin namang mag-offer services for trying to disseminate, as you said, the system of making sure that the public official does good.
Okay, I have a very good question. In fact, this is something that I have been asking the academic community in my district. Ang hinihingi ko po, hindi kasi ako masyadong hot. Doon lang sa parang usapan lang na ganito na walang hindi natatranslate into concrete actions. I always ask the academic community sa amin to be involved in rural development. In whatever form, halimbawa yung state university sa amin, which is headed by Councilor Gabis, the president of CBSUA is Councilor Gabis' wife. Pero yung sa akin lang sa akin mas concrete dapat yung participation. Hindi lang yung fora. Hindi ako contento na okay naman ang fora. But it should only be a means to an end. Pero yung sa akin, mas dapat natatranslate yung ganitong usapin sa anong gagawin natin after. Lalo na yung sa mga kabataan, I think mas mabuti sana na mag-create ng groups na magpapantay sa gobyerno. Kasi yun yung kulang sa atin eh. Yun yung kulang. Parang yung sustained na action. Meron naman ngayon ginagawa yung mga kabataan, pero palagay ko hindi sustained yung effort. Parang uso-uso lang kung ano yung hot na topic ngayon, yun yung, di ba, nung hot na hot yung PDAF, nandun lahat, yung DAP, nandun lahat, yung FOI, nandun lahat, ngayon na naman, 44, nandun lahat. Pero hindi naman nasusustain. Yung sa akin sana mas maganda kung yung halimbawa yung mga kabataan isipin what is it that we are passionate about, because it has to be something that we are passionate about, otherwise you will not be able to sustain the campaign. Pero halimbawa kung if you are passionate about health, mag-isip na tayo what particular aspect sa health. Like I'm always partnering with private organizations. We have senior wellness, we have malnutrition, we have breast cancer, etc., etc. Pero it has to be something really concrete. Hindi pwede yung motherhood lahat. Kasi kung motherhood lahat lang usapan, wala namang nangyayari. So yung sa akin mas, you ask yourselves, what do we have right now that we can share with other people? What issues are we passionate about? It doesn't have to be big. It can be something really small, as long as you make an impact. Actually, dun ako nabubuhay. We don't have PDAF. So, ako if you ask me, nung meron kong PDAF, we started our term July of 2013. Pagpasok lang namin, meron na sa aming instruction na you identify already what your projects for the year would be. Congressmen are given 70 million of discretionary fund a year. Senators are given 200 million. So yun. Parang hindi ko maate maglista. So what I did was I filed a resolution. Nung may PDAF pa sana, I filed a resolution proposing that the discretionary fund be converted into a performance challenge fund for our LGUs. Na meron din kami dapat na scorecards eh. para mapilitan yung mga LGUs na mag-step up. Pero since na-scrap yung PDAF before my resolution was discussed, ano na yun eh, parang wala nang point of discussing it. Pero it can be like that. Unang-una, halimbawa yung UPLB is an agricultural university. Ano ba yung pwedeng in your localities, siguro capacity building ng, di ba, as a school, you can do capacity building of communities. Halimbawa kami, one thing I found out was that DA will only help farmers who belong to accredited organizations. Yung pala yun eh. So what we did first, kasi konti lang yung accredited organization, so yung nabibigyan ng DA, yun na yun lang. Pero yung mga farm laborers, hindi naman naasikaso. So what we did was organize them. We helped organize them, help them get their accreditation so that they can also be beneficiaries of DA projects. Di ba ganun? Maybe what you can do is capacitate these organizations. Kasi sila yung nangangailangan talaga ng technical know-how, capacities, research, ano ba yung maayos sa amin. Kasi kami, we're largely agricultural. Pero poverty incidence is very high in my province. Parang Naga is an anomaly. Ang Naga, all indicators, nasa taas siya. Parang it's a model for government, most competitive city, etc., etc. Pero Camarines Sur, where Naga is, parating last. Last year, we were the most poor of all the provinces. And that there is no excuse for that. Because we're largely agricultural. Hindi naman namin pwedeng maging excuse yung calamities. Kasi pag bumabagyo sa Absol, bumabagyo din naman sa Naga. So bakit yung Naga nagsur-survive, yung labas hindi? Siyempre, yung sagot siguro dyan, poor governance. Pero hindi naman kasi tayo pwedeng mag-criticize lang na mag-criticize without doing anything. If other people won't do their work, let us do ours.
For additional questions,